is, okay. And he's a game developer, and he's going to talk to you about what he does and how cool it is.
Yeah.
So everybody, close your computers, please, and take your phones all the way off your desk, please. Thank you. And I guess later we'll ask questions.
Or you guys can ask questions whenever. You can just interrupt me whenever, like it can be conversational.
Okay.
There's a bunch of questions. So let me ask you guys this real quick. Like, this is a cybersecurity class?
This is computer science.
Oh, really? Oh, that's even better.
Yeah,
so it's cybersecurity.
That was what I'm teaching at Bob Jones.
Okay, cool. Are you guys programming in here? Okay, cool. You are the intended audience. This is C?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right, so first of all, I graduated from Bob Jones in like 2007 or 2008. I don't even remember. I graduated early. But I took C++, and advanced C programming in high school, just like you guys. And I don't know if you guys know this, but C programming, what you're taking now, is actually like the programming language for game development and a lot of really cool stuff like that. C is the language that modern games like, you know, Resident Evil, Call of Duty, the new Zelda, that's what it's written in. I mean, you guys are learning that right now in high school. And you're going to go to college with like a huge advantage over people who've never seen stuff like that. So that's how I started out too. The precursor to this game engine that I wrote was actually developed in high school for me. So I just want to kind of like talk about my journey and kind of like some of the stuff I did using what you guys are learning right now. I know you guys you've learned like printf and functions and stuff like that. And I'm like, I know you're probably like, wow, how's this apply to games? Like, seriously, I use printf like every day to debug. Like, when the game crashes, I have like a crash log where I still have to use little printf modifiers, %d and all that. It's actually useful always. You might not be learning graphics yet, but pretty much every aspect of what you're learning really is always used, even on PlayStation 4 and all those different consoles. So I'm the lead software guy, the only software guy on an indie RPG called Elysian Shadows. Any of you heard of us? Well, I'm famous on the internet, you know. But we are a 2D/3D RPG. We're trying to call ourselves like a next-gen 2D RPG. If any of you played like the older Zelda games or, you know, like the 2D overhead view of games like that, like Super Nintendo games and stuff. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to take that same aesthetic, you know, like pixel art-based old games, and we're trying to reinvent it with like a more modern approach using dynamic lighting, particle physics, shadow mapping, bump mapping, bloom lighting, things like that. And we're also trying to kind of move it into 3D a bit to try to kind of like reinvent it. And we're doing a lot of cool stuff like using 3D audio and a bunch of stuff like that to try to create the next gen 2D RPG. Right now we are supporting the Sega Dreamcast. Anyone even know what that is? Of one person. That's where I started programming on when I was a lot younger, and I just decided that if I'm ever going to make a game, I still want it to be on the Dreamcast, no matter what. They all failed.
Sega kept on trying to pump out so many different games and stuff.
Yeah, no, this wasn't one of. This was their last one, where basically, here's the controller, where basically they'd already screwed up so badly that it didn't matter that this thing was actually amazing and really ahead of its time. This was the era of like the PlayStation 2, GameCube, and all that. And I got into this, and you have to understand, this was back in the day before there was such thing as an app store or an indie arcade. Basically, for a kid like me to program for, it was impossible to program for a console because you had to be like a multi-million dollar studio with the development kit. And the Dreamcast, you could actually do that without modding the hardware or doing any kind of hacking like that. That's why it was huge with the homebrew community. And it's still huge today, believe it or not. This is what the controller looks like. It still looks cool. It has a screen in the middle. Like, that's still cool today. That's really cool. Come on, you know, it's cool. Alright, so why do you care about us? Why should you listen to me? Because we made $185,000 on Kickstarter. So, like, right now we hold the record for the state of Alabama as to the most funded for a game. We're actually late right now. We had like a bit of a shuffle with our teammates, and we're late, so everyone hates us on the internet. But actually, development's going fine other than the fact it's a late Kickstarter. This is straight off of the Kickstarter page. That's the final pledge. Actually, this is the part where I'll play the video on the Kickstarter real quick, just so you can see what the game looks like. You know, you guys know what Kickstarter, like, you always have, like, the video, like, demo, sorry, of, like, what the game looks like when you're pitching it on Kickstarter to an audience. Have you guys never heard of that? Do you guys know what Kickstarter is?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Did you have a question in the back? Okay. Let's see. Sorry. I think I pulled it up already. Question is, how do I get this to play over there?
You just slide the screen on as it goes that way.
Okay.
You either slide the tab or slide the cursor. Yeah.
Okay.
And you can just hit screen, yeah.
Thought that was easy. So, hold on just a second. Oh, there it is. Okay. It's not too loud, but this was like the sales pitch video. I just wanted to use this so you can see kind of what the game's like. So, okay, like old school 2D looking RPG. Also, the animations in this video totally suck. We redid our animation engine, so it doesn't look that bad anymore. And then you can see we have a dynamic day-night system, dynamic shadows, like we're kind of showing off. There's some dynamic lighting. You can't really see it that well because it's dark. Some of the particle physics and stuff. Right here you can see what I was talking about. This game is actually, the engine, the way I developed it, it's actually a 3D engine, so the game can change perspective between 2D and 3D. You guys ever seen Fez? This is the 3D perspective. It looks a little smashed because at the time I hadn't finished the 3D part of the engine. It looks a lot better now. But it sucks because once you put it on Kickstarter, you can never ever change it, even if it looks better now. Can you guys hear that at all?
I was highly influenced by games like Chrono Trigger and Secret of Mana. But over the years, as we've been working on it, our creative vision really got a lot more ambitious than it was initially. We kind of found ourselves wanting to add things to the game and engine. That
that's a shrine I made to myself for beta testing. So that's 3D particle physics being emitted in 3D. You can kind of see that, like, the perspective is not flat 2D. That's got dynamic lighting. That's using actual physics calculations, you know, like rings orbiting a planet, it's the same calculations there. So even doing physics, you know, in school is applicable to game programming. That was my old partner that stabbed me in the back. He's no longer with us.
Hear gamers and developers talking all the time about how great Secret of Mana is, or
yeah,
how
much John
inspired them to make some RPG, which ironically enough is exactly how this project started. But what you don't hear is you don't really hear people trying to push the envelope or do anything particularly new with the 2D RPG genre. I feel like it's a pretty stagnant.
You know,
what's that? Okay, it's almost over. I'm not sure either.
This is trying to take the heart and soul of what made
they can't hear it, I'm about to go over it.
And create a game that is very modern and very new and recreate them in a manner that makes them completely relevant by today's standards.
It's like a little sneak peek of the first boss, this section right here. We didn't actually have that boss animated or coded up yet, so we're like, man, how do we show him off? So like, we'll just have the character walk in and him growl so we don't actually have to show too much before the Kickstarter. But if you listen to the audio, we're kind of trying to do the same thing with that we're doing with the graphics. It's actually taking, have you guys ever heard of chiptunes? It's taking the audio composed and created on actual old hardware, like the Super Nintendo and Genesis. So it's taking a layer of like the old school stuff, but then we're adding like actual guitars and drums and orchestrated music on top of that. So it's kind of like a hybrid between old and new there. It's kind of the approach we're trying to take. I'll go back to the presentation now. I just wanted to show you guys that so you know kind of like what I'm talking about first. schools. Let's see. Okay. So the way we started off is actually we were in high school and we were just kids. We had no idea what we were doing. We actually kind of sucked at programming at first. It takes a long time to get good, to go from printf to actually doing graphics and stuff. So we were just meeting up on weekends, like drinking a bunch of energy drinks, staying up all night programming. And one of us had the idea that we would start recording ourselves, like programming, you know, like the game's crashing, you suck, you know? And we would do little things like, okay, whoever like crashes three times on camera has to chug Tabasco sauce. Just like really dumb things, and we would record it, and one of us had the idea to put it on YouTube. It was originally, you ever play games where you can unlock movies that are like, this is how the game's made, like in-game? Yes, we were originally gonna do that. Well, it wound up on YouTube, and it kind of actually wound up taking off somehow. We hadn't really planned on it, but people watched it, like, oh, this is kind of funny, this is kind of cool, so it kind of took off from there on YouTube. We started getting a bunch of subscribers, like, oh wow, I guess we'll just like make videos of developing this. So it gave like a behind the scenes look at the game as it was being developed. It was completely transparent. It basically allowed people to become emotionally invested in our game before it was ever released. And so we kind of built from there. This is us. Look how much hair I used to have. That's how young I was. How old this is look how big that monitor is. CRT. We'd like lug that back and forth to each other's houses. That is how crappy the game used to look. That is a screenshot from the Dreamcast, but we didn't even have transparency back then, just whatever, they're red. I don't think it was Collision either. But it's just to show that, you know, it takes a very long time to get to a point where something looks good in game programming. But if you're like persistent at it, then you'll totally get there, because this game used to look like crap. So slowly we started to become kind of accidentally successful. Like we got better, a lot better at what we did. We put more effort into the videos. This was around the time we were in college. We always tried to have an adventure to game development, like a half and half between entertainment and education. Like, yeah, we would be screwing around, but then we would go into like complex like physics calculations and the math and the code behind the scenes. So it's kind of a little bit of half and half. We actually got good at what we did. Like, I stopped sucking at programming, you know what I mean? The game actually got decent. This is a much more modern screenshot using a 3D perspective. This is showing off dynamic lighting, bump mapping, which are modern lighting techniques. Sorry. You can see that the sprites are being oriented in 3D space in the engine. This is all done in C and C++, by the way. Here's just a picture of, it looks kind of retarded, but it's just like demonstrating the rigid body physics engine that you can pick stuff up and shatter like a barrel or drop any item from your inventory. And once it shatters, it's broken into little pieces that are then recursively fed back into the physics engine. You can interact and kick around the pieces and stuff like that. And that's all using actually pretty basic physics from high school. Maybe you don't know how to program it, but the actual, what the physics engine's doing behind the scenes is pretty simple Newtonian physics at that point. This is just a screenshot from what I said. This is actually a demo area, or more like a beta testing area. And it's like an inside joke that it's a shrine I made to myself, so I had a picture of me. And now people are like, can you release that when the game's released? It's like DLC or unlockable. I hope I still have that level actually now. But basically, once we got good and we were doing this a while, the project slowly started to evolve. Originally, you saw from the screenshot, it was just like a purely old-school 2D RPG without any of the modern things. And like slowly as we're developing, we're like, man, it'd be cool if we had dynamic lighting. It'd be cool if we had like real physics. It'd be cool if like we could swap the 2D. And, like, we kind of got ambitious, and over time it evolved into something completely new that really had not been done before. It still hasn't really been done today. There's one game that's trying to do it. They totally stole our idea for the Switch. I forgot what it's called. Have you guys seen the launch game? It's not launch. It's a 2D RPG from Square Enix.
I think
that's what it is. God,
is it the farming game?
I forgot now. But yeah, I totally stole our idea. So I have to release this first. But let's see. So around this time, so this was... I had just graduated from college with a computer engineering degree. I went to work at a company called Adtran. I made a lot of money as a computer engineer, but it was kind of depressing because, like, I was making a lot of money, like, doing fiber optic routing equipment, but then on the weekend I'd be up all night working on this game, and we were becoming famous on the internet, you know, and that's more what I was passionate about. And around this time we got a publishing deal from, you probably never heard of this guy, he released a game for Sega Genesis, Pure Solar, and made a lot of money. There's actually a lot of money to be made in old school retro games. Not that that's why I do this, but there's actually a thriving market. So he offered us a publishing deal for the Sega Dreamcast to create actual physical copies of the game, like as though you went to Walmart in 1999, you know, buy it. So that was a publishing deal we got. We're really excited about that. Around this time, this game is now on Steam Greenlight. Well, it's not done yet, but we've been Steam Greenlit. It's on Steam, it's on mobile, iOS, Android. I can't really say anything officially, but in the future, we're hoping to come to like 3DS, PS4, all the modern, well, I guess 3DS isn't modern anymore. It'll be Switch now, PS4, Xbox One, that kind of stuff. But yeah, we are on Steam, so even if you don't have a Dreamcast, you can totally play this game when it comes out. So the point was that I was not content, like, in my job, and so I did something that was kind of reckless and dumb with my friend. But I don't know, it paid off, so we decided to quit our jobs, just like cold turkey, and sleep on each other's couches and charge up our credit cards, because we were going to make it on Kickstarter. Like, we're going to try to fund this game, and, like, we're going to live off of this game, and it's going to be cool, and we're going to live the dream. So, like, we quit our jobs, we got a bunch of loans, charged up our credit cards. Some of these other guys didn't even live in America. They were people we met on YouTube. Were like, man, this game looks cool. Can I be your artist? And we're like, yeah, sure. Cool. Yeah. So we had a bunch of foreigners on the team that we imported them into America, flew them in, and they stayed up for days with us. On couches, we slept in shifts trying to get ready for this Kickstarter. We almost went insane, almost died probably, but it's kind of worth it in the end. So this is just a picture of us like working towards the Kickstarter. I have whiteboard walls, so it makes you look really smart. It's cool. You can put code everywhere. People come in and think you're a genius. That's my ex-partner there, and that was just us during like this crunch time, staying up all night. Yeah, that's what the office looks like. Time. Very glamorous. This is my favorite picture of that time period because I look really smug, right? I look like I'm pleased with myself. We were getting interviewed for WHMT. We probably had no idea what we were, what we were, like little indie guys, like getting big on Kickstarter, and like we lived in Harvest, Alabama, you know, redneck town. They're like, oh, I don't know what Kickstarter is, but can we interview you? So at this time, we were doing interviews, podcasts, videos. Doing a lot of social media stuff. We were on gaming sites, just trying to promote our Kickstarter. Like, it was doing well, but it was kind of starting to get close because our goal was 150,000. And on Kickstarter, you're just sitting there watching, like, the projection, like, oh my God, I hope we make it, I hope we make it. Because if you don't make it, basically it's all for nothing and you don't get a penny of the money. And it's, you know, it's not very good to have a failed Kickstarter associated with your project. You know, it doesn't bode well for you in the future when people are like, oh, I should check this game out. I didn't even make it on Kickstarter. So we actually made it on Kotaku. Do any of you know what Kotaku is? Is this more my time period? Okay, two of you. That's okay. They're not that good. They kind of suck. They wrote us like a, they're massive. They wrote us like a passive aggressive, like, oh, this game looks okay. It's on Kickstarter. But that one post, we made like 8,000 bucks from the publicity in just a few hours for it. So that was pretty cool. Yeah, and we wound up actually making our goal. That was the team at the time. There's only, these guys are gone. Basically, that's us right now. One programmer and one artist. It's a whole lot of work for two people. If anyone has questions, you can just ask in the middle of it. I don't, like, it's supposed to be conversational.
Where'd they go?
Yeah.
Where'd they go?
My former buddy, like, you know, we were, like, working really hard, and we were under a lot of pressure. We thought we might be late to begin with. He would, like, kind of stop showing up for work, you know, when we're all, like, working our butts off, and he's, like, drawing a paycheck, you know, like, to pay for his house and stuff. And one of the guys who was, like, staying over from Poland, he wasn't even making a paycheck, you know what I mean? And this dude wouldn't show up for work, like, okay, we get you're stressed out. We even told him, you can just come in and play video games and we'll still let you be on the team, you know, just show that you still care, and he wouldn't, and he's drawing money from it. And so, like, it just got kind of ugly. And one day I woke up and his mommy and daddy were moving his stuff out of the trailer. He didn't even give us a heads up. Like, you know, he made like 20,000 bucks off of us at the time that he was there. And then he just like took off, ran off. And that was money we didn't get back. So that kind of sucks. And then we were left like with more work than we'd signed up for. And then everyone on the internet hates you because, you know, you're late. But there's nothing you can do. It's better to just like keep your head down and keep going. Because when the game's done, it doesn't matter. Like, there are plenty of games, man. This Zelda's been delayed. Anyone play the new Zelda? It's been delayed a lot, and it's getting like really good reviews. No one cares that your game's late when it's done. They just care that your game is good. A lot of the indie games that have exploded have taken years and years to develop, so it doesn't really get me down anymore. This is a picture of some of the main characters, like from an artistic perspective. This is concept art. We start off with concept art like this to kind of decide, okay, like what kind of, she was inspired kind of like by Lara Croft and Tomb Raider. That's the main hero. This is kind of like the kind of weapons he has. Kind of like the FF7 Buster Sword. This guy, we call him the Drunken Scholar. He uses guns. And we start off with stuff like this before we go down to little pixels to kind of like give us a better idea of the personality and how to draw them and stuff like that. Oh, whoops, I didn't do that. This is kind of showing like a before and after of an environment. These are like ruins, right? So these are like kind of lava ruins with like, he wanted to do like a Roman kind of architecture. So this is like a lava dungeon. At first he starts off with something like this, like draws it out, like, okay, we want these little chests. These are like the colors. We want lava to be flowing like this. And then he goes to pixels, which looks more like this. So that this shows before and after. And then after that, this isn't fully done in game yet. Then we apply like dynamic lighting, bloom, we add enemies and all that kind of stuff. So that's kind of like step one and step two right there, as far as the artist goes. That's that boss that growled at you. That's what his concept started from.
It looks like a magnet monster.
A magnet monster?
Yeah, because he's just like that's a collection cool. of stone. Just
I'll take that. That's cool. Have you guys ever played Shadow of the Colossus, or is that also too old? It was on PS. You played it?
Yeah.
So this guy was inspired by a game like that. Like, basically, this game was like the entire point is you're like this little dude, and like you're hunting things. That like the sense of scale was incredible on this game. You're this big, and then you're fighting things that are like as big as buildings, like this, and you're just like, holy crap! You have to climb up it and like beat them and things like that, and ride on their back. So we kind of wanted to do kind of like that, but these were kind of like animal things, beasts. We kind of wanted to do it with like a more technological, robotic-looking things. So these are like golems in our game, but they're still kind of like the massive guys with that same sense of scale that was inspired by Shadow of the Colossus. This is just kind of talking about like how gameplay works. This is way closer to in-game. That's still not in a level with final lighting and stuff. This is showing how like from an artistic perspective, he's like an aggregate of all of these different sprites put together. And we use something called skeletal animation, which is like the really old school 2D RPGs and like that video I showed you where I said the animations look like crap. They're just using a bunch of images. One image is like this, one image is like this, one's like this, and they're just swapping back and forth. And it kind of looks crappy, you know what I mean? We're using a new kind of animation for 2D that it wasn't really used much in the older games because it's a lot harder to do and it's a lot more expensive. It's called skeletal animation, where actually you're animating it. These different pieces, they're moving smoothly together like this. So instead of drawing 500 different images for like every pose, you know, of an enemy, you just draw these little pieces and they slowly get animated, like a 3D model, basically. It's kind of like modeling in 2D. And then that's him in a level. That's still without finalized dynamic lighting. This is just talking more about UI design is actually really important in stuff like this. Even if you go on to do UI design for like normal software, that's huge. Like, my wife is better at that kind of stuff. You can be artistic with programming. That's one of my favorite aspects of game development, is I was never artistic as a child. I still can't draw like barely more than a stick figure. Like, I really sucked at it, and I thought artists were like, man, that's really cool to be able to do that. So like game programming was kind of a way for me, through like dynamic lighting and rendering and graphical programming and stuff like that, to use like my programming mathematical expertise to do something that's like really artistic, you know what I mean? So it was like a cool release for me to be able to do that, especially when I'm doing stuff like fiber optic routing equipment during the day. You know, there's nothing creative about that. So that's kind of why I like game programming, is you get to be creative along with being technical. This is just like looking at different like inventory system, different equipment types, spells, ability. Yeah.
That little circle thing reminds me of Sword of Mana whenever you...
Yes, that is actually what it's from.
Where you decide to choose what weapon you want to use,
yeah.
Or whenever you want to select a specific item.
Yeah, that's actually exactly what it's from. Do you ever play Secret of Mana?
No.
Yeah, we got this idea from Secret of Mana, actually, but I mean, that's the prequel. Is it not? That's the direct prequel, or one of the prequels to Sword of Mana? They're the same series, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so that is actually where we got it from.
It's funny that you recognize that.
So it basically works the same way in our game. It's a nice way to be able to manage things quickly, like while you're in the middle of battle. It's pretty sweet the way that works. That's just showing off like artificial intelligence programming. Like, it's huge in video games. You know, you see, you mostly hear about artificial intelligence for things like robots, you know, and speech recognition and Siri, even though she's not, like, artificial stupidity, in my opinion. But games, it's actually very huge. It's huge because there are, like, a bunch of things on screen that all have to be doing things that make them seem believable. Like Call of Duty, you can't just have an army of dudes sitting there like idiots, you know, or running back and forth. And it's
what they do.
That's still what they do? Oh, okay, well, maybe you can do that. But it's even harder in game development because you're running in a world that is already taxing the hardware. You know, it already lags on a lot of platforms. It's already very processor intensive. So you have to be able to do advanced artificial intelligence calculations in it, especially top AAA games in like a very efficient manner. And that's like a big field in game development. So even if you're not that into programming and you're more into AI, even if you didn't think that you were into game development, that's still huge in game development, is artificial intelligence. It's just kind of showing, like, we make dumb little things like this with tiles to test the artificial intelligence. Like, you can see it. This was basically just plotting a path between two characters and, like, making her move along the path. And this is just kind of, like, showing the heuristics of the A-star algorithm. And that's actually a very common algorithm in video games. It's common in other things too. You know, if you ever seen the tool in MS Paint where you lay like two points and then it creates a line between them? Okay, maybe an old MS Paint was like an old paint program. Does Windows still have it?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I'm just making sure I'm not like that old. I use a Mac. I don't know, maybe it's gone now. But anyway, that uses the same algorithm that a lot of video games are using and stuff like that. So this is kind of talking about, so in addition to this game we're developing, also developed my own cross-platform toolkit and SDK to allow us to support so many different platforms with Elysian Shadows. We're also coming out on the Ouya, the Razer, and I don't remember what it was called, Forge TV. It also runs on the Raspberry Pi just because. I really like to support new pieces of hardware. It's just like a hobby of mine. I literally do it for fun. I really like enjoy hardware level shit stuff. Sorry, got too comfortable. Thought I was on YouTube. Yeah, so that's a lot of fun with me. And believe it or not, I was going to show you this. Even hardware can be very beneficial to game programming. Like if you go the electrical engineering route, I was going to show you a little side project that's indirectly tied to this, that can still be tied in with game development. So yeah, we're releasing an engine, we're releasing a toolkit, which is actually tied in with the engine. Now you can be making a level and you can send it to like a Dreamcast or remote device just by clicking a button and play through it while you make it. Kind of like Unity, but I'd like to think it's better. But where Unity is like a general purpose 3D thing, we're trying to specialize in like this next generation 2D/3D aesthetic. So if you were trying to make like a, you know, Call of Duty or something, you would use Unity. But if you're trying to make something closer to what this is, you would definitely use our engine. Which is all done in C and stuff like that. Make your own Dreamcast game. or make your own game for whatever using our tools. It really doesn't matter. So that was it. Does anyone have any questions? Let me ask you guys, what's the last thing you guys did in here, programming-wise? Like, tell me some of your programming stuff, and I'll tell you, like, how applicable it is to game development. Like, I just want to show you, because when I was in this position, right, I'm doing printf, hello world, like, formatting stuff with little printf modifiers, and I did not see how, you know, how is this going to lead into game development, playing audio, playing sound, like, and believe me, it really does. You can use, like, higher level languages like Python and things like that to make games, but actually what the AAA companies are using is what you guys are doing like right here, C and C++. So this is like really fundamental to doing it. This is the hard way to learn. This is like the way that is done by like the professionals, but this is honestly, in my opinion, the best way to learn. So give me some assignment you guys are doing, or give me like, did you guys use functions yet?
That's
statements.
Next unit.
Switch statements.
And,
oh man, those are
and
like
generating random numbers. How do you do that? How do you use generating random numbers?
Oh, that's pretty. It's like, okay, so any video game that has like chance drops, especially our online games. So like you kill this dude and then it has like a 30% chance drop rate to drop a certain weapon or a certain sword. You would do that with random numbers, like to calculate the loot. That's really common in video games. Is loot calculations. A lot of like particle effects and things like that look better when they're slightly randomized. Like if you have smoke billowing out of a place, you don't want it all coming out, like the straight line coming up, you know what I mean? You want like a little bit of randomness to the particles, like exactly where they're emitted from. So it's also useful in graphics and a lot of places like that. But it's really big in gameplay. And switch statements are so many places, I don't even know where to begin. Like those are huge in like AI, like you have different states. Have you guys used enumerations yet? So basically an enumeration is an integer. You can say, okay, you have an integer for state for like a dude running around. When this int state is 0, that means he's idle. When it's 1, that means like he spotted you, but he's not attacking you yet. When it's 2, that means he's walking towards you to attack you. When it's 3, that means he's close enough to you to hit you, but he hasn't hit. And then 4 is swinging the sword. So like in AI programming, you could just have a switch statement, switch case 0, you know, do the logic to like spot you, do the logic to walk towards you, case 1, do the logic to pull out the sword, case 2. So that's really useful there.
Yeah, they just start a program or finish a program just doing a calculator and making it robust.
Yeah, I remember the robustness is important. And like, I used to hate the robustness stuff, but like, man, when you're doing like what I'm doing with like a level editor, my team gets so mad every time something crashes. And if I release this game and like it crashes every other second, you know, there's gonna be a giant IGN article like indie developer game sucks hard and fails. So you have to actually, what's that?
There'll be No Man's Sky.
Yeah, exactly. So you have to be really careful with stuff like that. It's a pain to do the robustness thing, but it's really good to know that kind of stuff. Especially now, there's still a lot of like, when you get older and like you go to college, you're gonna use a lot of tools. They're like command line only, like what you're doing. You might not use it much on Windows, but a lot of software is written like that. Man, there's software from like multi-million dollar companies that has no robustness whatsoever. And I'm like, dude, like if I had one fraction of the bugs you have with lack of robustness, there would be like, the world would end and I would be on the front page of these gaming sites, like just being bashed. It's kind of funny that multi-million dollar companies can get away with stuff like that. Or that, or pay them for good reviews. Yeah.
So what's the highest level of math that you think that you use in the game that you're doing now?
Oh, man. Let's see.
Linear algebra, right?
I use a lot of linear algebra. But honestly, when I first started programming, man, I sucked at math. I made like D's and C's at first in math because I didn't see a lot of the point. And then once I got more into game development, first of all, anyone who says you have to know a lot of math to start in game development, that's a lie. That's not true. You can learn it as you go because I'm pretty nice. I really sucked at it. But as I went, I'm like, man, I wish I'd paid more attention to trigonometry and things like that. Sine and cosine, every time you rotate a sprite or a polygon, you have to be using trig functions like that. Like, it's that fundamental, you know? And I'm like, oh, but I don't remember how the unit circle works or anything like that. It's like 16, I remember drawing out the unit circle and being like, I wish I paid attention to this stuff. But if you didn't, it's okay, because you can still learn it. But stuff like that is definitely useful. And you don't have to know really advanced math. You really don't even have to know math, period, to start off with game development. Yeah?
How many lines of code do you think this game has?
Oh my God, I guess that a lot, man. It's like hundreds of thousands. Because you have to understand, like, it's a game, it's an engine, it's a cross-platform SDK. But just the game itself is still massive, man. Like, tens or hundreds of thousands, I don't even, like, it's gigantic. I need to just count them one day, like use a program so I can tell people that this is exactly how many lines it is. Keep a count on it. Yeah, on the website, that's a good idea. So people are like, oh, you're not working on the game. I pushed anorector semicolon. That's a good idea. Whoops, that's a really good idea. Yeah, we'll do that. You guys have any other questions?
How much farther do you think until completed?
Hopefully it will come out later this year. I'm not for sure yet. Problem was, we had like a big contract in the works where like we all really got our hopes up that it was going to come through and it was going to fund a lot of us and bring in a lot of new people for like, so it's me and an artist. We thought it was going to bring in people doing stuff like level design and music. So we were kind of depending on that when really we probably shouldn't have. We probably should have been recruiting ourselves and not dependent so much on that, and then that fell through, and that was not good. So like, it really depends. If something like that were to come through, which supposedly that might still come through, that would be a lot faster. But I don't know. I don't want to give like a super concrete estimate just in case it doesn't. So we're just hoping for like towards the end of the year.
So
kind of
looking back, do you have any regrets so far? Things that you could have done differently?
Yeah, I'm not a person of many regrets, but like Kickstarter, it can be brutal if you're late. People are not nice on the internet. I should have, the problem is on Kickstarter, like, oh man, $185,000 seems like so much money. Like, I was making $75,000 myself as a computer engineer at Atran. Like, that's a lot of money too. So it was a gigantic pay cut to go from that, which then gets taxed, Uncle Sam takes a bunch of money away from you to pay for, I don't know, people who never learned programming. And then you also have to split it up between your team. So in the end, it actually was nowhere near as much money as people think. Like, man, you're rich, you're a jerk, like you're late and you're rich. But in reality, you're like, man, I can barely afford toilet paper on this money. But the problem is that you don't have enough money to pay a real engineer, because like I said, they should be making like 70, 75, at very least $60,000. So you kind of had, like, I had to go with friends, you know, that maybe were not up to the task. Like, I had been emotionally invested in this game, like, my whole life. You know, I really wanted to be a game developer, and some of the people on the team, it's like, they had never programmed or done game development until, like, we hung out and decided to, like, do this together.
Programming?
Yeah. Oh. Yeah, but it was, like, some of the team members could not do what you guys are doing. They didn't know printf, they didn't know C. They were using a language called Lua, which is much more simplistic than what you guys are doing right now. So, you know, I don't really know that I could have done much different other than waiting to do a Kickstarter so that I have more done, so I wouldn't have to have relied on them. Because it's not like I would have had enough money to hire really good people anyway, but I don't know. That is kind of a regret I do have. It's right there. Yeah?
How much is the game gonna cost?
It depends on the platform, and that's because if you buy it on Dreamcast, it has to be like manufactured in a fancy plant in China. But if you buy it on like Steam or anything like that, it's just going to be like $10, pretty standard, or on your iPhone or whatever. But if you buy it for Dreamcast, since it has to be manufactured and all that, it's going to be like $50, like a brand new game, but you get like a fancy case and all this stuff. Which I know you're like, man, why would anyone buy on Dreamcast? 100,000 of those $185,000 is from Dreamcast purchases. Not even kidding.
They even sell Dreamcast in the store?
No.
I didn't think
so. No, you can buy it on eBay. But no, they don't sell it in the store. They should, because of how many people are still into stuff like that. But, so that brings me, I was going to talk about a little about, are you guys into electronics? Sweet. Yeah, this is kind of like a side project that I did that's indirectly related to ES. So like, I was kind of like burned out and needed to work on something else. It was between that or like sitting on my butt and watching Netflix and like, not doing anything because then people be really mad at me. So part of having like a good Dreamcast game is like there's this little screen here. This is the memory card, right? This is the Dreamcast memory card. That's sweet. Tell me that's not. It has a screen built in. It's like a little Game Boy. And so it plugs in here, and like some of the games, like all the good games will show extra data here. Like there's a card game on Dreamcast, which is actually really cool, and like it shows your hand here so no one can see your cards. So this is used as a display when it's like plugged in here for extra information. And then when it's separate like this, a lot of games have mini games like Sonic Adventure 1 and 2. I don't know if you guys have ever played Sonic Adventure. Man, Sonic was so cool when I was younger. You could offload your little guys called Chows here and train them kind of like Pokemon and then put them back in the game. And that was really cool back in the day. Like my friends and I would have them at school and you can take two of them, right? And link them together like this in battle. Tell me that's not awesome, man. Remember that, like, under the desk and stuff? That's how the teacher wasn't looking. So, but the problem is that, like, I can't invest all this time making these extras for this when a lot of people bought the PC version. Like, man, why do I care about that? I don't have a Dreamcast when I wanted to work on stuff like that. So what I did is I actually wrote an emulator. Do you know what an emulator is? You know what an emulator is. I wrote an emulator in software, basically, to emulate this thing. So if you don't have a Dreamcast, if you bought it for Steam or whatever, you can basically use your iPhone as a VMU like this, and you can set it up next to you as an extra display or offload onto there and play a little game and put it back. So that was actually like a really cool little hardware project. And I'm in, you can actually download that emulator right now. It's already released, and it has a lot of really cool features and stuff. This like little emulator for this little 8-bit thing, man, I went overboard. You can plug in like an Xbox 360 controller and play this with like full analog stick support, like full screen it HD, even though it's like tiny little resolution. It's pretty cool, and you can use the triggers to like speed up and slow down time, and you can save and load state. But that's on the site. You can check that out. So that was like a pretty cool hardware project, and I'm also in graduate school right now working on my master's, so I'm like really nerdy and I really like this stuff. So another thing I'm doing in graduate school, so I wrote an emulator for this thing, so I'm pretty good at like how it works and the architecture. I'm in a hardware class now where actually I'm trying to create a VMU2 on an FPGA board. Don't worry about what that means. Like it's basically I'm trying to make like a little chip that acts as a like a next generation version of this, and I want it to be like 16-bit instead of 8-bit and add color to it and make it backwards compatible and higher resolution and backlit and battery and stuff like that. So like that's like really low level electronics and like electrical engineering that, you know, indirectly is also applicable to game development, so that's pretty cool. Also my emulator, like this little thing right here where you can link them up and like battle and stuff, is the only emulator ever for the VMU, not that there are many to begin with, that can support doing this over an internet connection. So like through the internet you can trade and stuff. I think it's pretty cool. Yeah.
I just looked at the thing of Sonic Adventures and $100 on Amazon.
It's $100?
Yeah.
For Dreamcast?
Yeah. And then there's another game called
Shenmue?
It's $125.
That's really good. Okay, well, let me tell you guys something. If you buy a Dreamcast, you can play burn games without a mod chip. That's why it's really famous. I did not say that. But anyway, you can burn any Dreamcast game, including ES. That's why it has such a huge following, is because there's a certain way that you can burn games so that you can play any homemade software. And that's how I got into it, is I had a Dreamcast. And while I was online, and I was looking up, probably, it was like 14, looking up cheat codes for like Sonic Adventure or something, and I found this community of like college students and crazy people that were writing their own software for this thing. Like they were writing emulators and stuff, and I could play like Mario World for Super Nintendo on my Dreamcast, and I just remember being blown away by the fact that you do that. I was like, wow, I really want to be able to do that, you know? So that's kind of why, that's actually how I got started in game development. But yeah, so if you buy Dreamcast, doesn't matter how expensive they are, you don't need to buy them. Torrent.
Oh my gosh.
Anyone else? Alright, well cool. You can check the game out on the site. I would have brought like a little demo thing. I have a demo of this, but it probably isn't that big of a deal. I didn't bring the adapter for my laptop. And my laptop's kind of crappy. I could probably only show you like the SDK because the graphics are a little too demanding for my little piece of crap map book from like 10 years ago. So, yeah.
So if you have a version one that you're working on now,
yeah.
When you're working on a version one, do you have in mind like a version two or a sequel?
Yeah, man, I get asked that
so much.
So
do you already
so
start working
much.
On that now, or do you like
no.
save some stuff for the sequel that you want?
That's really hard because like I'm the kind of guy I want like I don't like to think. The problem is like stuff like this takes so long and so much effort that in my opinion the second you start thinking of like the sequel or what you want to do after that, like you're taking the focus away, and a lot of people will be like, man, after I make this game I want to make this game, and then they don't ever finish this game and they just jump to this one. It's like programming ADD, like it's a real thing. So I try not to think that far ahead, although I've always said like if this is successful, since like the tools are open and stuff, like you can mod the game, there will be a large modding community. We could release like extra episodes as downloadable content. Or, okay, if I made a version 2, there is one thing I would do that I can't do in version 1. I would like to add online multiplayer, because that's massive, and to do that now would make it delay way longer, and I can't afford to do that. But that's the one thing, man, if I could have supported that, like, I wish I could have done that. That would be a version 2. So like if I make enough money off of the first one, then I want to release like the online version.
Why would it take so long to add multiplayer to an already single player game?
That is a very, very good, very low level programming question. Okay, so what happens is an online game, first of all, so imagine you have all these variables that are like for a player and for like an enemy and stuff like that. When you have an online game, basically you have to be sending the variables back and forth to communicate to synchronize the two games. So basically for all the different variables, you have to be sending them back and forth. Like when this player moves, oh, you gotta send this player move to the other player so that it updates on their screen. When this enemy dies, you have to send it back and forth. That's a gigantic amount of communication, a gigantic amount of overhead. It's a massive amount of work because for every feature like that that you add, you have to go and add all this networking stuff. So it's like a common saying in game development that if you're making a game online, it needs to start off online to begin with because of the amount of work. And when you're doing that kind of stuff, you might structure the code differently to support moving, to support sending the data back and forth. Have you guys used functions yet? Maybe not?
That's next year.
Okay, so like a function is like printf is a function you're calling printf, right? Or you guys use scanf too?
Yeah.
Yeah, so those are functions, right? So to move a dude, it's I might not, instead of just x, his x coordinate plus 1, which would move him like 1 unit, instead of just directly doing that, I might make a function set x plus 1, so I'm moving him 1 unit, and then that function will automatically handle the update for me. So when I call this function, all I'm doing is passing how far he moves, but then that function is communicating with the other end. So you see, that would be like fundamentally restructuring the code to work like that. So there are design decisions like that that would have changed if you had originally known that it would be an online game. So that's a good question. So yeah, that's a huge amount of work. Anyone else? All right, well, cool. Thanks, guys.